I had an interest in history as a child when I was about 6 or 7, because I saw myself as a young person without a past, because I was adopted at birth, didn't know who my parents were, and couldn't see how I interacted or indeed had anchor points with the world in which I found myself. And so I found history interesting because I knew it came from somewhere, not quite where, and that having an understanding of the world would be very helpful for me. And my earliest interest was in bushrangers. I mean, I'm 8. I mean, that's what you expect. The kid's 8. He likes his interest in bushrangers. That's all right. And then from there, I started getting interest in political history. And then for reasons unknown to me, the Navy said I could join when I was just turned 16. And since they were paying the bills, they thought that I should write naval history. To which I said, you want naval history? They said, yeah, we want naval history. I said, fine, let me tell you about the Navy's greatest disasters. And so some of my work moved into those fields because plainly that's what people were interested in, and also that's what publishers would publish. And I'll come back to that at the end, because to some degree, publishers drive what gets published, and therefore to some degree what people actually then come to write. For me though, I think that as I look back on the years I've been writing history, I need to acknowledge that it's both personal and professional. And over the last 35 years, I've tried to understand the two institutions that have had the greatest bearing on who I am and what I have become, and that is the Anglican Church of Australia and the Royal Australian Navy. And thinking about those two institutions, because it is true, institutions shape the people that we become and to some degree guide the kind of behaviour that we exhibit. I've tried to research and record, interpret and present the history of both institutions to make sense of what they did, why they did it, and how that's had a bearing upon me. And I remember my very first captain saying, he said, you need to understand this, Tom. He says, the Navy has glorious traditions. The Army has customs and the Air Force just bad habits. Now, I've had tri-service jobs, so I totally reject that slander of the Army and the Air Force. But I do think it important that if you are part of an extended family and it has an institutional form, that you understand it, because it will partly shape you. And if you want to understand yourself as the beginning of understanding the world, to understand your preference and your prejudice, then understanding those institutions are important. It's also, I suspect, for me, I'm trying to find order and purpose in those institutions, because I esteem order and purpose. That's the kind of person I am, and that's what I look for in the institutions, which at the same time, it seems to me, have regarded order and purpose as being integral to identity and destiny. And so it is with me. I remain the greatest mystery in all the world as far as I am concerned. And if I can't work me out, then you can't either. And it seems to me, therefore, that history continues to be, for me, part of your journey into self, but self-understood in the world, because I'm conscious it's a dialectic. Now, in assessing my own work over the past 20 years in church history, I would have to say that I wanted to do what I have done, in part because I've been surrounded by inspiring people. The very first journal article I ever published, I owe a debt of thanks to my friend John Moses. 27 years ago, published some of my work. John took me seriously, more seriously than I took myself, and I thought, maybe I've got something to say. I possibly didn't, but John thought I did, and took a punt. And so people like John Moses, who are interested in ideas and the history of ideas, I thought, hey, this is really interesting. When I came here to St. Mark's, my friend Robert Whittycombe was here, and I could see that you could really do church history. It wasn't a once-er. Like you wrote one essay, yep, church history, done that. In fact, it could be a lifelong study. And then I had the good fortune of joining with a community of church historians of the 1990s, of which Brian Fletcher was one and Jeff Treloar was another. And I thought, I want to be like these people. They somehow have an ability to look at the past and to draw things out that didn't seem to me to be apparent in first inspection. I found with Jeff, and particularly with his work, he had an ability to describe sanctity in ages other than the one in which I was living, that I thought, I want to be able to do that. And with Brian Fletcher, it was an ability to see church history as part of something much, much bigger. It was Bruce Kay that suggested I write an article on, because he'd written on Manning Clark's vision of religion, I wrote on Jeff Blaney's. And I got to know Jeff and work with him when we judged the Prime Minister's Prize for Australian History. And he kind of put up his hand and said, yep, you've nailed it. I do religion really badly in all of my published work. He said, I hadn't realised how badly until you'd actually printed it, you know, reproduced it, interpreted it, and said, you know, it's missing. And some of his later stuff, he's tried to deal with that, having pointed out that it actually has no consistency through his published work. So for me, meeting Brian, someone who said, look, it's part of something bigger, but it's got an integrity of its own, I wanted to be able to be someone who could write that science kind of work. And that's, it seems to me, why I thought, well, I'll put naval history to one side and that I would write church history. But I got to the point, perhaps similar to Brian, where I think I've probably written my last major works on both the church and the Navy. And I'm quite comfortable about that. It's been made easier to say I've probably written my last big church history on the basis of three things I shared with you. The first is this. I hoped that church history would serve as the basis for institutional renewal. It hasn't. And the bureaucratic inertia of the modern institution, church, has been, for me, a cause of frustration. That's why I'm now a cattle farmer. The second thing that I would say is that I believe that church history is increasingly being used to commend rather than to critique theological polemics and ecclesiastical partisanship. As a non-aligned historian who revels in being a party of one, I find myself something of an outcast within my own community, and this is disconcerting. It's no surprise that of the parish appointments I've had in this diocese, every one of them has almost been at the fringe. And now I live on the fringe of the diocese. I mean, I think it's the centre of the world, Tarrago, why wouldn't you think that? But other than when I was here at St Mark's, I was kind of on the fringe in Bender and in Wagga, and now in blessed Tarrago. And in one sense, I think from the fringe, you get a better view of the centre than perhaps anywhere else. But I have to say that I do think that partisan church history is on the rise, not on the decline. And the third reason I think I've probably done my bit as a church historian is I deplore the notion that providence can or should be discerned in church history. Yet, I find this notion is gaining ground. I was trained among secular and apolitical historians who were suspicious of meaning imposed on history by ideologies and religions. And I know my own work has been described by some as being too worldly, and this has been the cause of some disappointment. I can't say in the 1950s God did that, but God didn't do that. I just don't find it within my view of history or the confidence that I have as a historian to make those sorts of judgments. Now let me stress, and don't feel sorry for me because it won't have any effect on me anyway, but I don't have any regrets about the work that I've done in church history. I'm content with about half of what I've produced, and I'm glad that it's prompted conversation among special interest groups. I think that's all a historian can reasonably hope to achieve.